My name is Mshell Bishop, and I wanted to really open up with you guys a little bit about why I decided to walk away from the bodybuilding world after 4 years of serious competing.
I was a boy just like every other boy.
Something that I absolutely love so much. It was literally what I lived for.
And into my world.
It was something that helped me overcome a lot. And for those of you who don't know about my history, I used to have nighttime eating syndrome. I wrote about that in my blogs before. My blogs are not up right now. But nighttime eating syndrome, basically, back when I was like 16, I got up to 150 pounds. I was so unhappy with myself. I was 5'2". I was very, very self-conscious. I hated looking in the mirror. I felt like I was always wearing big baggy clothes. I hated it. And it was a joke in high school where people called me Butters. You know, what's up, Butters? And they would grab me by my cheek and, what's up, butt? And, you know, it was funny, whatever. I let it go. But I fell in love with running. And I did a lot of research on eating right, eating healthy. Taught myself nutritional breakdowns for fruits, vegetables, proteins. I started eating a very low-carb diet, lots of protein, lots of vegetables, a little bit of fruit, and I thought I was doing it the right way. I did a lot of, like I said, research, and all of a sudden I started realizing that I was losing a lot of weight, and I fell in love with running. Ever since I was 8 years old, I've been a runner, and I did 5K with my dad. My goal before I turned 18 was to run a half marathon, which I did. But that is kind of what I went to. One of my girlfriends had lost a lot of weight in high school, and she was like, yeah, you know, I've been running 5 miles a day, and I don't eat bread. So that's all I knew. So I cut out my bread, I cut out my carbs, and I started running like crazy. So I got up to anywhere from 3 to 7 miles per day. It was awesome. I remember, you know, my first time running, I couldn't even make it a mile and a half. It was horrible. I hated the whole thing, but, you know, before I knew it, I was crushing 3 miles, then 5 miles, then 7 miles, and I started seeing my weight drop. I went from 150 to like 130, and then 120. And I remember this progression from junior year all the way to my senior year of high school, losing weight. I started feeling more confident in my clothes, I felt cute, people were noticing. Before I know it, I was 103 pounds, itty bitty. For 5'2", you know, didn't look bad, but I really had no muscle. I didn't have too much upper body muscle, it was very thin up here. I had some decent muscle on my legs, but that was where I was. So I fell in love with running, that was my outlet. Then I started having cravings in the middle of the night, and I would wake up and I would eat in the middle of the night. And it was something that I literally battled for probably 2.5 good years. Put on Ambien, all these different things, trying to help me not to wake up and eat at night. Get up early, work so hard, and then before I know it, it's the middle of the night, I'm getting up, I'm eating food, I'd wake up the next morning, feel bloated, realize what I did the night before, cry, I would hate myself for it, would overdo cardio again, restrict my calories again. Before I knew it, I was literally creating insomnia, and it was causing me to literally, every time I would lay in bed at night, I was like, oh my gosh, I'm gonna get up and eat. I would literally get up and eat every single night, and it was creating this horrible habit. It got to the point where I would try to have to like lay upside down at night, because if I took myself out of that normal sleeping spot, it was like, it would calm me. I don't know, it's weird, but I was able to fall asleep. That's how I started fixing, and I was able to sleep through the night. Well, I remember I was dating a guy, and he introduced me to Mike Davies. He is the man who helped me get on my fitness journey. He taught me pretty much everything that I ever learned as far as weightlifting goes, cardio goes. He gave me great nutrition plans. I would dissect them because I was crazy like that. I would literally break down every single nutrient on every single plan. I had a book of everything he had ever given me. It was like my own little journal. It was really fun while I created it, but I had a bunch of quotes in it. I can actually show you guys. Hold on a second. It was like my little journal. See, it says, Mshell, this is when I first started. And I wrote down a really inspirational quote, all men dream but not equally. Those who dream by night in the dusty recess, can't say it right, of their mind, wake in the day to find it was only vanity. But the dreamers of the day are dangerous men, for they may act their dreams with eyes open to make it possible. It just became a really inspirational book for me. He gave me cardio programs, so I would just like go through and tape them in my little book. As he gave me my meal plans, I would go through and write out all the meal plans he would give me, and then I would go through and break them out. And I did this for like everything he ever gave me. So I started learning good nutrition. Like, I wrote down everything. This is my baby. That is how much I was looking for help. I was literally a sponge. I would soak up anything. And at that time is when I started my journey with God. And so when I was dating this guy, he was a really strong Christian and I admired him. So I started going to church with him. He had me reading the Bible. I was crazy about this guy, you guys. I was 18. He was 31. Call me crazy, but I'm being an open book, so please don't judge me. I fell for him. I did. And during that point in time, I remember he always called me his angel, yada yada. And it was so contradicting. I slept at his house. We actually lived together. But yet, he was so strict about the Bible, tithing, reading every day. The way I looked at it was, this is the man holding my hand with my walk with God. I'm gonna trust him. He says it's okay, it's okay. But what I learned is that whatever the word says, it's the word. There's no, well, they said it's okay. And this turns into the competing thing, but I began to realize that I was living in sin. Before all of that happened, I was in the gym one day, and I remember I was like doing Facebook posts of, you know, all of these scriptures and stuff, and this guy, Gerald Murphy, he was a friend of mine in high school. He was really strong on his walk, and he came up to me one day when I was in the gym and said, "Hey, Mshell, don't let others look down on you because you're young, but be an example for those through your faith, love, purity, and speech." And I was like, wow, Gerald, wow, that's so perfect for a time like this. And you guys remember, I was a personal trainer. I was very, very young. I didn't go to college. I got my certification. I jumped in, and I just started working hard. I was very young, and people did look down on me because of my age. And it went hand in hand. But anyways, as the story continues, I was sitting maybe a couple weeks later at the coffee table with my boyfriend. And we were sitting there reading the Bible because that's what he wanted me to do every day. So I did. I was reading and reading, and he was reading, and he goes, "Hey babe, this verse is for you. Don't let others look down on you because you're young, but be an example for those through your faith, love, purity, and speech." And I was like, oh my goodness. When I was at the gym the other day, Gerald actually told me that. And he goes, "Yeah babe, it's perfect for you." So a couple days later, I'm in Genesis still, and I'm getting so bored. I was just like, ugh, this is so dry. So I flipped to the back of the book, 1 Timothy 4:12. "Don't let others look down on you because you're young, but be an example for those through your faith, love, purity, and speech." And I was like, what? Like, are you kidding me? Like, three times? Are you kidding me? So fast forward to a couple days later when I was sitting at my kitchen table with my mom. I went home just to hang out with her, and I was talking to her, and my mom's always been a very strong Christian woman, and I was sitting there, and I said, "Mom," so I was telling her the story about the three times, and I said, "Timothy," and she said, "1 Timothy 4:12," and I was like, are you kidding me? And she said, "Baby, I was listening to The River the other day, and there was a young girl giving a testimony with her walk with Christ, yada yada, and she said that verse," and I was like, that is perfect for Mshell, because Mshell is so young, and she's just now starting her walk with God, and I was blown away. But I have always thought, you know, that has been 1 Timothy 4:12. That is probably the biggest quote scripture in my life, because it has applied to me so many times. And so fast forward, this man that I was with cheated on me multiple times, and I was so young, and I was that girl who always said I wouldn't stay with somebody if they cheated on me, but then I was in those shoes, and I allowed it, because he was gonna change. I saw him cheating on me on Skype, through text messages, and then I finally let it go when one of my clients came in and told me that she was sleeping with my boyfriend, the man that I was living with. And that is when I turned my back to God. I was like, how dare you? I am pursuing you. I am tithing. I am here 19 years old, working sun up to sundown 7 days a week. I wasn't working 7 days a week for long because that guy was telling me I needed a day for fully Sabbath. So I was working 6 days a week, sun up to sundown. 5 o'clock, the gym would open. I would get my break at like 12 or 3, and then I'd go back in for my nighttime session and leave when the gym closed. I was just like, how can you do that to me? Somebody who is so young, pursuing you, and you do that to me. You take away somebody that I was in love with, somebody that I cared about, and that was kind of it for me. I shunned God. I turned away. I believed. I went to church on the holidays. I went to church for Christmas, Easter, the days that you were supposed to go, and that was that. Well, that's when I found my love for competing. Like I said, I was working with a great trainer. He was helping me get ready for this stage, and after 5 months of training with him 5 days a week, I did my first bodybuilding show. I was still eating throughout the night, but I made it. And so fast forward, my first off season, which means when you take a break from competing, was horrible. I remember getting up to 146 pounds. I competed at 117 pounds. I binged. I ate a lot of bad things, like I think a lot of competitors do. I hadn't found that balance yet because I deprived myself so much. I continued to wake up and eat in the middle of the night. And then finally I decided that I thought I could do this on my own, so I still had Mike help me with my nutrition, but I trained myself and I got ready for another show and it was great. So fast forward, I mean, you guys, I did this for like 3 years. Last year, 2014, John and I broke up. You know, it's part of my story. He moved to Houston, Texas, and during that period of time, I met a man by the name of Jake Riff, and he came into my life. It was very slow. It was very subtle. We never actually dated or anything like that because he wanted me to walk with God on my own and not because of him. In that period of time, he told me so many different things. He told me that he wants to be so into God that when God calls him to do the most foolish things, he does it. And at that point in time, I was thinking he was referring to my Mshell fitness business, which was booming. It was huge. It was a business that I had built from the age of 19 up to the age of, I was 22. It was great. It was booming. I loved it. I absolutely loved my job. And for him to say that to me, I was like, wait, are you telling me that you think that I'm supposed to like give up my job? And he said, no. He said, and I really do believe it was on his heart to tell me that. But he said, no. He said, but I know people who have given up million-dollar businesses because God has called them to do something else. And I just kind of like let that roll off my shoulder. He also made a few other points. We would be up talking till like 2 in the morning, and he would always get in his car and drive home. And I was like, why are you always driving home? Like, I have another bedroom here. You can stay here. And he was like, no, I don't want to stay there. It's okay. Like, I'll drive home. And I was like, this is weird. Like, it's 2 in the morning. You have like a 45-minute drive home. Just stay here. And he was like, no. Like, I don't do that. I've never done that. And so I was like, whatever, you know, I respect that. So finally he came out to tell me that, well, I've never been with a woman like that before. I've never slept at a woman's house for the sole purpose that when I marry somebody someday, that's going to be a gift given to me from God. It made me realize that the Bible is written the way it is for a reason. And if we live our lives the way God tells us to live them, not sleeping with somebody before marriage, not sexually being with somebody, what I've realized is that he wrote this, the book, the way to live your life for a reason. Because can you guys imagine not ever being with somebody like that? Most of you guys who are watching this, I know you've been with somebody. Like, this is personal talk, I know. But you have. And if you haven't, oh my God, I envy it, because you're gonna have such an amazing marriage and life ahead of you. And imagine this. Imagine never being with somebody and you falling in love with a guy, or you falling in love with a girl for the sole purpose they have a good heart, that you love the person that they are. Imagine that. Then imagine the day that you're standing across from the altar and you're holding each other's hands. And you say, I do. Your wife or your husband knows that you are wanting to spend the rest of your life with them. And you've never even been with them before. You are marrying them for their heart. That's it, for nothing else. And then that night, truly getting to give yourself and make love to the person that you're wanting to give the rest of your life to. That's what marriage is. The reason that Jake didn't want to stay at my house is because getting to wake up to a girl with her sweats and her hair pulled back in a ponytail and her makeup off and all of that stuff, that is a gift from God. Those are the little things that nowadays are taken for granted. So many people just see people like that nowadays. It's nothing. But can you imagine waking up to that for the first time? How special your bond is going to be. How much you're going to love that person. Well, when he shared that with me, I texted my mom and dad. And I told them, I said, I need you to keep me accountable. And from this day forward, until I marry somebody, I will not be with them physically, and I will not live with them. Jake and I ended up going different ways. He told me that he couldn't be with me. He felt something in his heart saying that I needed to pursue God on my own. But let me tell you guys something. The Mshell then didn't understand. The Mshell then tried to get Jake to break. But you can stay at my house, come on, it's no big deal. The Mshell then didn't respect Jake the way I should have. The way a Christian woman should have. And he needed somebody strong because you guys, the human body, this world is full of temptation. And if you don't have somebody on the same playing field as you, who understands your heart, you know how hard it's gonna be. So if I was at the same point he was, I would encourage him to say, go home. Don't do this. We can't do that. But instead I did it. And so we ended things. And that is where a couple months later, I think it was about a month and a half later, something in my gut told me, God told me that I needed to call John and ask him to marry me. So that's what I did. I remember sitting in my car, I couldn't believe it. I've always desired a huge wedding. I've always desired that, the princess wedding. But at that moment when I wanted to call John, none of that mattered to me anymore. All I knew is I wanted John in that moment, right then and there. I wanted him for the rest of my life. I was done. My mind was made up and I wanted John. And so I picked up the phone and I asked John to marry me. Yes, he said yes. I flew down there the next day. You guys, most of you know the story. Flew down there the next day. We got engaged that Saturday. Got the ring of my dreams. Got my marriage license on Monday. Got married on Thursday. And then flew home, packed up my apartment. Then we went to the beach and eloped. And that is where our life started together. And then that's when the real struggle came. So I was at the place where I feel like a lot of us competitors get, where you just need a deadline, you just need a show to prep for. And I was at that point. I didn't have any more dates to focus on. So me, I needed another date, another reason to say no, another reason to help me get shredded. Shredded because that was what my confidence was in. That was what my happiness was in, was me being shredded. That's all that I was living for, was to be shredded, to look good. Honestly, I reached out to Dana and I asked her if she thought George Farah would take me. And she said yes, but she also had her reserves about competing. I emailed George Farah, pretty much one of the best trainers in the world, and he said yes. You guys know how tempting that was? Like, I was at the point where I was like, I'm going to the Olympia, there's nothing that's gonna stop me, I can do this. And that is when my friend Shannon King came into my life. Shannon and I actually met each other maybe a month prior. She came to my house for a business meeting and we just fell in love with each other. We hit it off. She was so sweet. She was a Christian woman. I remember talking to her about a couple different things and I had tears in my eyes and she was like, yeah, you could tell that she was agreeing with me. So we started hanging out a lot. We got very, very close. And I remember when George Farah said that yes, he would take me, I was so excited. And I told Shannon, I was like, you know what? Like, I'm gonna help you get ready for a show too. We're gonna do this together. And she was like, yes, let's do it. Thanksgiving came around and she went home to see her family. When she told her dad that she was thinking about competing, he got upset and he didn't want her to do it. And I remember us working out in the gym a few days later and I could tell something was off. She just was herself and she was like, I gotta tell you something. I was like, yeah, you know, you can tell me anything. And she goes, I don't think that I can do the show. Just seeing myself in a bikini up there, I can't do it. I have a husband. And so I was like, yeah, you know, I totally understand. Fast forward a couple weeks later, Shannon made a post on Instagram. There was a picture of a woman in jeans and then a woman with a really sexy outfit on. And it was talking about how it's okay to feel sexy. Shannon made the post and it was like, no, it's not okay to feel sexy like that. You save that for your husband. The world is getting sexier and sexier and flaunting it all the time. That's all she posted. And somebody comes on the page and says, are you against bodybuilding? And she said, yes. She said that I can't see myself being on stage naked like that and being provocative and having other men lust over me. And I actually got pretty upset. And at that time, I felt Shannon, it was my own ego and pride. It wasn't Shannon, it was my own ego and pride. And I felt that she was attacking competing. All of a sudden, she's calling something that I love so much a sin. And it made me start feeling like I was being belittled. And I was like, how could you say that what I do is a sin? I am one of your best friends and you're gonna sit there openly on public and say, I think bodybuilding is a sin when you clearly know that this is all I've done for the last 4 years. And it made me really, really upset. And to the point where John and I really started shunning Shannon. It was kind of childish of us, you guys. I thought she was attacking me. I remember getting so defensive. I started pushing Shannon away from me. I actually told her that I feel like any time that I get close to somebody who's strong with their walk in God, I get hurt and I get burned, and that I was never good enough and that I was somebody pulling them towards sin. And that's really how I felt. Like, man, you know, all of these people, Jake, Shannon, like two of the strongest people that have encouraged me on my walk with God, I now feel are pushing me away because I'm like temptation, like I am sucking them into the bad side. It was horrible. So I shut her out. I was done. I remember praying about it, and all of a sudden, I decided that I needed to step away. And this was it. I also, in this process, this is kind of personal, but it's just part of my testimony. I was really struggling with tithing too. I started doing it every single week. And I'm gonna share something with you guys because this is incredible and God is just so good. So I'm gonna share something with you guys, not to bring up the tithing thing, and it's something that we shouldn't even talk about really, but this is how good God is and this is why I wanna share this with you. I remember I was taking all these steps forward and actually went to church for the first time here, and we went to the welcome thing and they started talking about tithing and it was really heavy on my heart. I was really wanting to pursue God and they said how important it is and that it's something that you need to do. I was talking to John, and John really wasn't for it at first. His story is incredible. Oh my goodness, it's so incredible. Long story short, as I prayed about it, I reached out to a lot of people who I admired their walk, and they told me to do it. And I still was praying about it, and I was crying about it, because I was scared, and I don't know, I just didn't agree with it at the time. And I remember praying and saying, God, like I cried. I was like, God, you have to give me a sign that you want me to do this. And so I was in the car the next day, and I remember finding a book between the seat of the truck. And I asked John, what is this book? And he said, oh, that's something that we're given at church. So I open it. It's like this thick. I open it, and the very first page says, my giving covenant. And I actually have it in my kitchen. It says, my giving covenant. And it said, the very first thing said, I will give 10% of all my first fruits. And then it starts talking about all of these different things, and it had to do with tithing. And so it was like September 14th, I believe, I signed it, I dated it, and I said, from this day forward, I will never miss giving 10%. And so that is how good God is, you guys. But this is how strong I was on my walk. I was taking baby steps just because I was like, I want him to bless me so much. More than anything, it's I want to go to heaven someday. And the more of the word that I know, it scares me, because there's a difference between not knowing the word and sinning, but then knowing the word and sinning. Like, that's scary. The whole competing thing. Hang on. Okay, so the whole competing thing, it just clicked for me. I just decided that I needed to pull away. I said, you know what? The Bible clearly says, like Shannon has made so many good points. Number one, for me, you guys, bodybuilding was prideful. I did it because I loved the compliments. I loved being in shape. You guys remember how I was telling you that they used to call me Butters. Well, in high school, they started calling me, I can't believe it's not Butters. That gave me a high, you guys. Like, I always loved showing people that I could do it. Bodybuilding became prideful for me. It became very selfish. My meals, me, my workouts, sleep, everything became before everybody else, my friends and family. I had an ego. And ego, I say it stands for edging God out. Oh my gosh, I had an ego. I'm a married woman. I'm married. That means that this belongs to one person. It's my husband. Nobody else needs to see this. That's for him. I don't want other guys knowing, getting to see everything that my husband gets. And then another sin is allowing men to lust over you. There are married men in the crowd, and by you putting yourself on stage like that and posing like that, you are allowing people to lust over you. And I didn't want to be the product of somebody else's sin. And then talk about being so promiscuous. Literally, they used to tell me that I needed to, quote unquote, the judges. Look at them dirty and win them over. What? Getting up there and shaking your goodies around for everybody, but saying, I can't. And I'm not going to judge anybody. But that's why I couldn't bring myself to stay in it. This is something, obviously, that every single person individually needs to pray about. But you can obviously see why I backed away. You guys, the Bible is black and white. It's black and white. You can live by it, or you don't. Choice is yours. But I refuse to be somebody who knows what the word says. To know what it says and to bluntly go against it. Because I want to. Because it makes me happy. Yes, we sin daily. But this was something so blunt that I love so much. That I was putting before God. It was my happiness. It was my security. And when you realize that something other than God is your happiness, your security, your everything, your world, that's when you need to make a change. It was the hardest change that I have ever had to make. Ever. Because I overcame a horrible thing with it. And I was so in love with it. It's all I knew for 4 years. It was scary. I felt alone. There were so many times that I just wanted to jump back in, get back on prep. But I didn't. Why? Why? Because what would God think? He would look down on me and be like, "Oh, Mshell. Means I love myself more than I love God." Think about it. The choice is yours. Yes, it's hard to let go of that lifestyle, that world. People being like, "You look so awesome, you look so great. Mshell. It was hard to let go of. My ego was hard to let go of. But you know what? My marriage has been so blessed. We've been able to bless our family in ways that people never even have any idea. The things Don and I have been able to experience. You better believe every single bit of that glory goes to God. I don't want to know what would have happened if I continued to compete. It's like that picture where the little girl's holding a teddy bear like this. She's like, "I love it so much." And then God has a teddy bear so much bigger behind his back, and he said, "How much do you trust me?" The little girl doesn't want to get rid of her teddy bear. And she puts it down. God pulls out of it. He is so good, you guys. Beginning of this year after walking away was the hardest thing that I've ever done. I would look back at pictures and cry. You guys want to know why I don't post pictures of my competing days? Because I don't need... My pride and ego is the only thing that needs for people to comment on those things. I don't need to relive those days. That was cool. But that would be the old Mshell. Posting those pictures just to get comments. Just to get, "Oh my God, look how awesome," and all these tags. Like, it's cool. I'm glad that I could inspire somebody. But I want to be on a bigger stage. And I say that in the most humble way possible. But a stage where I can speak about God and share his true message and share his true word. And in order to do that, I had to step away from my stage. Give my stage up because he has something so much bigger. And I have to trust it. Since then, I have found so much balance in my life. I accept myself for how I am. And you know the most crazy part? Become somebody who you want to attract. My life is amazing. In here. Yes, there are days when I miss being shredded. When my clothes were hanging off of me. But you know what? How can I hate the body that God has given me? How can I hate the body that God has blessed me with? I am beautiful. I am beautiful the way I am, and you watching this right now, you are so beautiful, just how God made you. You don't need a stage. You don't need some fancy meal plan, some little sparkly bikini to feel beautiful. Because God has big plans for you. You just have to let go and let God. Become somebody who you want to attract. In me, I want to be surrounded by so many amazing Christian women. That's who I want to surround myself with the rest of my life. I want my husband to be surrounded by strong Christian men. Because you know what? We won't give up. John and I have a beautiful life to live ahead of us. Yes, I'm sure we'll have days that we get frustrated, but we will fail forward. As long as God is the core of our marriage, which means letting go of these worldly possessions, these worldly desires, which I'm still always battling, just like you, we're human. But the biggest thing that I had to walk away from first was the stage. And I did it. So I hope if you're somebody who's been thinking about this, that this is the encouragement that you need. I'm not telling you what to do. But I hope that this can at least let you know where my heart is and why I decided against it and how my life has been since. You're gonna be okay, I promise you. You just have to make a decision and stick with it. Until then, I'll be here to encourage you. That's it. Have a great day, everybody. I hope this video was helpful. I hope it didn't offend anybody. But this is my life. I believe that God called me away from the stage for a reason. I have found so much self-love and happiness. And I hope that I can inspire and encourage other women to do the same. So, stay beautiful. I want to give a special thank you to one of the strongest women that I have ever met, Shannon King. Because without her, I would not have walked away. And God put her in my life. And it was so hard. I said some mean things. I spoke out of pride. And she was just doing something that God was telling me to do. And I know it wasn't easy. We had an amazing friendship. But she was bold in her message. And because of that, because she didn't back down, because she didn't hide, because she was afraid that she was going to offend me, because she stood so bold in her word, my life is forever changed. So thank you, Shannon. I absolutely love you.